Oksana. This is going to be a case-based talk, and there won't be any statistics. In my experience of last 17 years for developing Transradial, I have come across several problems, and we have tried to sort them out, and we have taught all those tricks to so many. And I hope it can be useful to all those who use Transradial approach regularly or intermittently. Local inflammation is now a past. This used to happen when people used to use a non-hydrophilic sheath, and it was being dealt with anti-inflammatory to be given for some time and local antibiotic application. Pseudoaneurysm, the real setting for pseudoaneurysm is an octogenarian diabetic female. The incidence is low, but if you are doing transradial very regularly in high percentage, you will come across this problem every 3 monthly or 4 monthly once. And it can be dealt with, you know, low compression with an ultrasound guide, and you can observe and it disappears. But the aneurysm, which is very lateral, can be dealt with a small surgery on outpatient basis, and surgeon can do it, and patient can be discharged in a couple of hours. Depigmented scar also is not a problem now if you are practicing the proper hemostasis technique. And this is because of the inadvertent pressure over the radial. This problem happens in our part of the world. Focal radial artery spasm. Spasm is a problem for any beginning radialist. It can happen with intermediate experience or even the most experienced radialist. and this is an example, like you can come across whenever you experience resistance with your wire or catheter, you have to inject and see, and you come across the reason for it. Diluted contrast was added to the nitroglycerin and verapamil combination, and you can see how it disappears, the spasm disappears. Diffuse RS spasm again happens with mainly with younger female or very old female who are diabetic. And here, you know, this type of bad spasm can happen. You have to give the cocktail of your choice, whatever you know your lab uses as a standard of care, maybe nitroglycerin plus diltiazem or nitroglycerin plus verapamil in a couple of doses. You can see some improvement, and then a soft tip PTCA wire can be negotiated under fluoroscopic guidance, and slowly with counterclock rotation, the catheter can be maneuvered across. And usually, if the spasm breaks, you know, you don't get any resistance throughout. Balloon-assisted tracking, we already published a couple of papers on it, and this is to avoid the razor effect to the tortuous radial artery or a very small radial artery. We are using a balloon which is protruded half outside the catheter, maybe diagnostic or guide catheter, at a modest atmospheric pressure 4 to 6, which helps tracking the diagnostic or guide catheter in very difficult situation. This is the in vitro demonstration, and it can be utilized in some very difficult situations, like this is a very small radial artery with spasm. After a couple of doses of cocktail, the spasm has been relieved, but still it is very small, and we are supposed to do a left main bifurcation using a 7 French guide, and this is how the guide catheter moves with a 2 mm balloon which is being protruded with balloon-assisted tracking, and the T-stenting can be done without much of the problem. Another example you can see here, that there is a very bad spasm at the junction, and this is a setting for perforation, so you have to use balloon-assisted tracking to avoid, you know, injury in that area. This is another example where there is a long spasm, and again a PTCA wire and a balloon-assisted tracking can help you. perforation. How do you suspect perforation? Whenever patient complains of pain or discomfort in the forearm or arm, you have to inject and see, and there can be an expanding hematoma or there can be a perforation which is going intramural. This is an example, an expanding hematoma and severe pain, while pushing the wire, injection. And if you are a beginner, you can stop at this stage, do a hemostasis and defer the procedure maybe after several hours. But if you are experienced, slowly negotiate the PTC wire across the perforation, use a balloon-assisted tracking, complete the procedure. This catheter will act as an internal hemostatic device, and it will tamponade the perforation, and injection after the procedure can be clearly, you can confirm that the perforation sealed. Another example of a bad perforation, and which is going in the muscle, balloon-assisted tracking. Once the procedure is finished, we have injected and seen that the perforation is sealed. This was third example. This was after the procedure. Patient had severe pain and expanding hematoma, and there was a perforation, and patient was heavily anticoagulated. And here, we negotiated PTCA wire and kept the guide catheter with using the balloon-assisted tracking in the brachial artery for 45 minutes, and then we injected. This is how it has been kept, and we injected and did a digital subtraction angiogram, and you can see both the perforation sites were sealed. And this is how the forearm hematoma manifests, and this is how sometimes very rare, unusual sites of hematoma you can come across when your wire touches some small branch of the axillary artery or some small branches of the subclavian. And those hematomas are to be managed conservatively. You may have to do ultrasound and then repeat ultrasound to see the regression of hematoma. And the local hematoma in the arm and the forearm are to be managed using the simple procedure, that is the blood pressure cuff. You have to inflate the blood pressure cuff at a pressure 10 to 20 millimeter higher than the patient's systolic pressure. Keep it for 5 minutes, release it for 1 minute, and then you can go on repeating it several times, and that will disperse the hematoma. Catheter node is a problem because radial is a small artery, and if there are very bad subclavian tortuosities or the axillary or the innominate area, there are tortuosities, you come across this type of catheter node. Here you can see the distal part of the catheter is not moving, and we could remove the node using the wire inside, and this is how we could reduce the node and remove the catheter, and we could demonstrate the complex tortuosity. Another case, whenever you have a catheter node, try to bring the catheter down just above the bifurcation in the brachial artery. Put a blood pressure cuff in the arm and inflate the blood pressure cuff at a pressure which is 20 to 30 millimeter higher as compared to the patient's systolic pressure to fix the distal catheter, and then putting the wire inside, 35 or 38 wire inside, you can easily rotate the proximal part to reduce the node, and then this is how the node is reduced under the fluoroscopic guidance, and then the distal end of the sheath will help you reducing the node completely and removing the catheter without any problem, and this is how it is being demonstrated. This problem you will come across on regular basis, maybe once in 6 months or 12 months if you are doing very complex cases in very old population. Another example of a catheter node, and dealt similarly, we have brought it down just below the elbow, and blood pressure cuff has been inflated at a high pressure, and in the same way under fluoroscopic guidance, the catheter node has been reduced, and this is how we have to be careful because it can lead to some injury, so under fluoroscopic guidance, you have to remove. And after every removal, we injected to make sure that we have not done any damage. In this example, after removing, we saw that there was a perforation and spasm. And here again, we used balloon-assisted tracking. We went up And we finished the procedure, and while we came back, we could see, there was no perforation. This was a case of arterial usuria and anomalous coronaries arising from the right, even the left is arising from the right. It was a very complex coronary cannulation, and this is arterial usuria. In the process, we created a node there, and the node was removed in the same way, like we pulled it back, brought it down at elbow, put a blood pressure cuff, fixed the distal area, and this is how we removed it. And that's how we removed it. And one case, which was actually a nightmare for us, there was an atherosclerotic plaque which was dissected, and we created a very bad dissection in the axillary and subclavian region. And here, just like an interventionalist working in the coronary, we used a soft tip PTCA wire, entered the true lumen, and then we went in with the diagnostic catheter. We finished our diagnostic procedure, and then there was an intervention. We finished the intervention using the guide catheter, and while coming back, you can see this was sealed. So these are the few complications which I thought worthy of showing you guys. Thank you very much for your kind attention.